Welcome to Inland Empire Alive, bringing you issues, events, and perspectives from throughout San Bernardino and Riverside counties. I'm David Brady, and on today's program, I'll be talking with Mikki Cichocki of the San Bernardino City Unified School District's Board of Education about her priorities for the students and the district. That's today on Inland Empire Alive. Well, here with me now from the San Bernardino City Unified School District is Board of Education member Mikki Cichocki. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much. It's good to be here today.
So before we get into kind of your current role and what you're doing with the district, I want to go all the way back to the beginning. You grew up here.
I did.
So what was it like to be a student of San Bernardino schools and now kind of have this sort of lofty perch where you can have a difference, from the sort of the top of the pyramid, as
well,
it were?
Well, you know, I've pretty much spent all of my life here in San Bernardino. I grew up here. I went to school, as you said that. And then I came back and I worked for the district for over 30 years. And when I retired, some folks asked me about, you know, running for the board. So I did. I've been really dedicated to our community pretty much my entire life. I loved growing up here. It was a great place to grow up. I love the fact that we're close to the mountains, and I just, you know, I still have many friends that are still in the community, and so I just couldn't think of anything better than continuing to give back to the community that gave to me.
Now, I know that your parents taught. Tell me what that meant to you as an inspiration for your later career choices.
So I didn't really originally plan on being a teacher. In fact, at one point I was at San Bernardino High School the same time my mother was there, and that did not go very well for the two of us. So one of us had to leave. That was me. But you know, both of my parents were very inspirational, and you know, anytime I post about them on social media, there's always students of theirs that, especially my mother, but for both of them, that come back and just tell me stories about how wonderful they were, or you know, just what they meant to them and how they it inspired and impacted them. My father was an orchestra teacher here in the district. In fact, he opened Cajon High School. He was the first band director up there. My mother taught choir for most of her career. She ended teaching world history at San Gregorio High School, but she was also a choir teacher, and they just were amazing. And I think I really modeled myself as a teacher after my mother, even though she taught high school and I taught elementary school. But yeah.
What values did they instill in you when you decided to become a teacher? What did you want to emulate that you saw in them? And again, like you said, it was a little bit prickly because it's tough being a kid, you know, when your parent is a teacher, you know, in the same school.
Everybody knew them.
But and they think they're beloved sometimes, and you're like, well, you know, they're not the same at home.
Yeah, well, and you know, with a name like Cichocki, it's not like, you know,
right,
like, oh, you know,
you must
are you
related
be related to? Yeah. But you know, they both were very dedicated to their craft, but they cared about kids. And they were, you know, they were so compassionate, and you know, every student was an individual and welcome, and you know, my mother did a lot, is particularly for her students. If there was a student in need, you know, she found a way to make sure that whatever it was they needed was met. It didn't matter, you know, their background, their differences. Their cultures, you know, she was just there for them. And so I knew that when I became a teacher that I wanted to be that kind of teacher, that, you know, every student that walked into my classroom, every child that walked in my classroom was my kid, that, you know, was my student, that they knew that they were home in my classroom. Or, you know, as I went on in the district and did things outside of the classroom, you know, with youth court, that they knew that I was there for them, and that they always had an opportunity with me, and that I saw them as an individual that had potential and you know, could succeed, much like they did with their students.
What was that spark that made you make that change? Because I know you went into the corporate world originally after college, but then there was this decision that you needed something more.
So it's kind of ironic. So when I left, I worked for Xerox, and when I decided that I didn't want to, that copiers were not very meaningful, although they're very important because
they are.
When one goes down, especially on a school campus, the world comes to an end. But
we remember the purple mimeograph machines.
Yeah,
the
smell. I missed the smell. Everybody, if you were of that age, you're always talking about the smell. But I actually left because I wanted to go back and do sports journalism. But I couldn't get classes. At the time, the Cal States were all impacted, and I couldn't get classes. And I took a job as an instructional aide. I'd already had my college degree. They offered me a job subbing, and one day in the classroom, and I was hooked. You know, working with children, with students, affected me in a way that nothing else ever has. And to be able to help our next generation succeed and fulfill their potential, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like it.
Well, let's jump ahead. So you taught for decades, and then what made you want to move into an administrative role and join the board? Because that's a much different, there's a lot of different expectations. There's so many eyes on you. You know, not everybody agrees with kind of your vision and your priorities. So what made you want to take that leap?
You know, I think I saw it as a way to continue helping our students and ensuring that every student has every resource that they need to be successful. And, you know, sometimes when you're in the trenches, like you can't always get everything you need. And so I wanted to be available to, you know, to parents, to our staff and our stakeholders, to our students, to try to see how can we make sure that the policies that the board is creating, that the environment that the board is creating is one that nurtures and grows our kids so that they can be the best that they can be.
When we come back, we'll have more with Mikki Cichocki with the San Bernardino City Unified School District after this.
We all make choices. When it comes to alcohol, kids make choices whether to drink or not.
Bye, Dad.
Bye-bye.
Remember, I'm going to Alex's party tonight and sleeping over.
You have fun. Hey, Em, have a seat for a second. Remind me about that party again.
Alex is just.
And adults make choices whether to talk about it. That's true of parents and every other trusted adult in a kid's life. Kids want to know our expectations when it comes to alcohol and other drugs. They want guidance and honest answers to their questions. And it makes a difference when the message is consistent and part of everyday conversations. So talk with your kids and help lead them on a positive path. Because when you talk, they hear you. For more information about talking with your kids about underage use of alcohol and other drugs, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov.
I'm talking with Mikki Cichocki of the San Bernardino City Unified School District Board of Education. So tell me a little bit about your priorities within the district for its students and for the district as a whole.
Well, you know, probably one of the most important things for me is making sure that we create a culture of success.
What does that look like to you?
School campuses that are clean and safe and welcoming, classrooms that are well equipped, that teachers have what they need to be able to teach their students, that they are not overwhelmed or overloaded, so that they can't, you know, meet the needs of individual children. Because, you know, when you whether you're at elementary school and have 30 kids in your classroom or high school and have over 200, you know, students on your roster, you need to be able to try to reach and teach every child that comes through your classroom. You know, also that we have the kids are feeling safe, you know, on their way to and from school. School safety is probably, you know, a lot of folks know is one of my biggest passions. It's something I did before I left the district. So making sure kids have safe routes to school, that they have opportunities for to resolve conflict in a safe and peaceful order, that they're free from bullying or intimidation from their peers. So those are also some things. And then that, you know, the academics are important, but you know, it's usually, I don't know about for you, but even for me, it's a handful of students that go to school for their English and their math classes. They often go to school for, you know, that touches them. So career and technical education or sports or fine arts. You know, those are some of the things that sometimes get our kids to school and get them to their math and English, social studies, sure, and science classes. So
how do you motivate those students who, again, don't see the value of subjects like, you know, math or ancient history, and they don't see the relevance, and how is this going to help me get a job? And how do you break through to some of those attitudes? And sometimes it's with the parents as well.
And I think sometimes it's having conversations. I mean, you know, having time to have conversations with our students, either as staff, and it doesn't matter whether you're the school secretary, the principal, or their classroom teacher, you know, having those opportunities to have some kind of a relationship with a student that allows you to say, hey, you know why you need English? Because someday you might need to write an email for work and you don't want it misspelled. You want to know how to use punctuation appropriately so people take you seriously. You want to be an entrepreneur. You know, I had one student, so for a while I did school discipline, and I had a student, and they were like, oh, I don't need to go to school. I want to be El Chapo when I grow up. And I said, okay. I said, El Chapo ran a multi-million-dollar business. He thought I was going to, like, blow him off and yell at him, right? I said, he ran a multi-million-dollar business. I said, if you don't go to school and understand basic, you know, accounting and investment and, you know, how are you going to run
You're just stuffing money in a mattress.
Yeah, and that you know, that made him think for a minute and, you know, how to do it. Whether he was just trying to, you know, yank my chain and see if he could get a reaction, you know, that was an opportunity for me to teach him and reach him on his level to say, this is going to be important to you, even if you're El Chapo.
For all the decades that you have lived and worked in this region, how have schools changed? What are some of the challenges that exist today that maybe didn't exist when you were a child?
I think probably the biggest challenge is social media. Mm-hmm. There's a pressure from social media that we didn't have because it never turns off. Right? It's there in the evenings, it's there in the weekend.
It's addictive.
It's addictive, and it's easy to hide behind. So I would say one of the biggest challenges is social media and that pressure to kind of grow up or to, you know, meet some artificial target that other people are posting online, whether you know them or not. So I think that's probably the biggest change in schools today. And in some ways, I think we're asking a lot more of our students earlier. And so making sure that, you know, we're always developmentally appropriate for our students so that we're meeting them on their level.
How important is it to stress that it's not work-life balance, but that school-life balance, that mix of, you know, not overloading kids with extracurricular activities and homework and all these demands, and recognizing that they have, you know, busy lives sometimes outside of campus?
I mean, we're in a stressful world, whether you're 12, 18, or 28, or 58, you know, our world is stressful, and I think making sure our kids also have opportunities to be children, and you know, to enjoy their years to 18, because, you know, life is going to be hard enough when you're an adult and having to pay your bills. So understanding and trying to help them to understand, look, you need to enjoy it. You don't need to be an adult right now. You need to be a kid. You know, yeah, you need to do your homework. Your school is your responsibility. But you also have a responsibility to, you know, to play.
There is value in play. There is value in relaxation and recreation and friendships. And
all of those things. And that I think that's also important for us to teach our students. And, you know, because relationships matter. And, you know, it's going to probably be one of the most important skills is how to have, build strong relationships with colleagues, with peers, with adults. You know, it's probably going to be one of the greatest skills we can teach.
Before I let you go, I want to ask, how can parents be more involved? That's always a question that schools grapple with.
You know, I would ask parents, you know, get involved in your school. There's parent committees, there's school site councils, watch the board meetings. You know, feel free to come to any of our parent advisory committees or our open meetings. Feel free to reach out to any of the board members. We have an amazing superintendent right now. We have an amazing board, and we're all, you know, willing to talk and be there, but you know, we do. Parents are our number one partner in education. And so, you know, we want to do what we can for your kids, but we need you to meet us there and help us help your student be the best that they can be.
Before I let you go, I want to make sure we give the web address for the district to learn everything that's happening in the city, everything that's going on, the great things going on in the schools, how to contact your board member. It is sbcusd.com. Mikki Cichocki, thank you so much for being on the program.
Thank you. And I'm happy to be here to tell you how San Bernardino shines.
Wonderful.